and welcome to Contact. With me is the Minister of Culture and Tourism, Darlene Marzari. Darlene, welcome.
Thanks, Sonja.
I have seen you pop up at various meetings with the motion picture industry and tourism, and you've just been one busy lady. How is it going?
Since November the 6th, when the new cabinet was sworn in for the provincial government, it has been, well, 8 weeks till Christmas, basically, of go, go, go. I spent, well, the most wonderful 16-hour days of my life visiting with and meeting with the film industry, the cultural industries, the coalitions of various cultural groups in every community, the hotel industry, and the tourism industry of British Columbia in all its various shapes and combinations of people and energy. It was a fabulous introduction to the people of the portfolio that I have. Now I'm spending January consolidating and pulling together people's plans and aspirations for what they want to see in tourism and what they want to see in culture. And right now I'm sort of pulling that together, trying to match that up with the budgeting process that we're entering into. As you know, April will be a cruel month for British Columbians because of the nature of the deficit that we face provincially. But nonetheless, I'll be doing the best I can inside culture and tourism to see that we have effective, efficient, terrific programs that capitalize on people's energy and great ideas, so that culture and tourism, two seemingly differing entities, can find places where they can intersect, and we can attract tourists to BC using the cultural talent that we mm-hmm. have here, and also survive and thrive on their own, where there's a lot of serious work that needs to be done in the tourism industry to match research that we know things about people who come to BC that we haven't really applied in practice to what we offer when they get here. So there's stuff to be done on the tourism side. And on the cultural side, I'm trying to develop a budget and a security of funding that will let people know in training and in actual production and in the film industry and the writers and the actors, that there is a future for them mm-hmm. here in BC, and one that we haven't capitalized on thus far. So I'm loving it. I have never, I don't think in my life, enjoyed taking on a challenge like the one I'm facing now and getting it done.
Well, it shows your enthusiasm, and the words that I'm hearing from the various groups, she's open, she's listening, but of course the reality is this is almost like the honeymoon stage, isn't it?
Sure it is.
It's new, it's fresh, you're new, people mm-hmm. have great expectations. I want to talk about the film industry. It says that in 1990, on paper, 190 million, maybe last year 250 million, how do those mm-hmm. figures sound?
250 million last year. The third biggest production city in North America, Los Angeles, New York, Vancouver.
Which was in the sun the other day, yeah. which is quite something mm-hmm. that we, I mean, the distance between LA is ideal, but the way our dollar's been going up, it's fascinating to see that we've taken it from Toronto, the big,
yes.
to a much smaller city like Vancouver.
Well, Vancouver has the talent. It's got 4,000 people who are prepared to work in the film industry. It doesn't have enough training institutes and agencies and mm-hmm. funding to provide training for people who want to be technical personnel on mm-hmm. films, but mm-hmm. we're building that capacity. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. We've got some studios here. We have to obviously expand our ability to provide filmmakers with what they need in terms of technical assistance and ancillary services. Mm-hmm. We need post-production facilities here, I've been told time and time again. This is all part of consolidating a real mm-hmm. top-notch, and dare I say, world-class facility and venue for filmmakers
and
throughout the world.
As I've heard you say, too, environmentally a clean industry.
It's clean and green. It doesn't pollute.
And that's what we like. The spin-offs, according to the article I read, were $1 out of every dollar spent in the film industry, another two are left here. They're talking about $570 million left here because of this industry.
Yeah, it's a big one. It's a big one for us, and it's a sleeper that people really haven't... I think that British Columbians were so aghast and so amazed that Hollywood would discover us 10 years ago or 15 years ago that they never really took the whole thing seriously. Mm-hmm. Now we have to understand that we are desirable to the Hollywood folks as they look for new venues and as they look for labor pools and as they look for places with the kind of services that films need. But now we also have to think about the fact that we have a fabulous indigenous Canadian filmmaking capacity with Canadian productions, Canadian producers, and many writers. And we don't want to lose that because it's the artists in our community that are ultimately going to save the country. Mm-hmm. It's my theory. I've done social work for 20 years. I know that our health industries and our social services are absolutely integral to the country and how people define themselves as Canadians. But when the time comes to actually defend our country and to talk about the Constitution in human terms, it's our writers, it's our artists, it's our filmmakers that are putting forward the case and reflecting back to us who we are and what we are as Canadians. So the building of the Canadian industry is something that's very dear to my heart, and I'm beginning to see ways to articulate that better and meet the people who actually do this, and hopefully we'll be able to strengthen the Canadian capacity as well.
What's interesting is that people of all walks of life admire the actor, the performer. People love to go to stage and see life reflected in front of them. Yet, when you really get down to it, compared to any kind of job, there are so many thousands of actors who make under $10,000. Mm-hmm. A day's pay is good, but when you look at what they're earning per year, it's not fair somehow because they have trained. And you said at the meeting for the performers that you sympathize with that and something should be done. Don't have a magic wand, but what do you see in your crystal ball that could possibly be done to help all these wonderful performers that give so much joy and escape to people?
Well, they are workers. Performers and actors have a craft. Mm-hmm. They are workers. Do you know that right now, I'm sure you do know, that right now they are not covered by employment standards legislation. Mm-hmm. They are considered basically self-employed people, small businesses that run themselves as consultants. The New Democratic Party, and it's certainly something that I've said before and came out of a workshop that I did last February with the performing and the artistic community around Vancouver, we want to ensure that actors, actresses, craftspeople are properly covered by employment standards, that they receive proper recognition for the work that they do. Mm-hmm. Now, whether they do that between their unions and the agencies and corporations that they work with, whether they do that by seeking the same kinds of standards in the workplace as other workers can expect, doesn't matter to me. I'm really, really ready to hear anything about saving safe workplaces and non-exploitative situations. Mm-hmm. So we're ready to talk about that, and Mo Sahota in labor will definitely be working with me on the preparation of legislation around.
So what could that possibly mean to the actor who's listening that you want to see them covered under the labor standards?
Well, most definitely they will be incorporated into employment standards legislation, and that basically means safe workplace. Mm-hmm. It basically means that they will come under the purview of legislation that regards people as workers, that actors like farm workers, like nannies and domestic workers, are not considered eligible for the status of worker, basically. Mm-hmm. And we'll want to make sure that that happens.
So we're not talking specifically about any kind of benefits that they would inherit from this?
Employment standards doesn't deliver benefits into your hand in terms of cash. It delivers securities. and access to the law and legislation as workers. Yeah.
Now, the other thing that comes to mind, you talk about the indigenous business. Hollywood has come here, Hollywood has left millions of dollars, and Hollywood also has given us a real shot in the arm saying the actors are good, we can use them, we don't have to fly everybody here from LA. The technical people are superb.
That's right.
And they're blown away. There are times there are not enough technical people available for all the movies. There was something like 13, 14 being shot before Christmas. I mean, it's phenomenal. And people like it, it's exciting. Mm-hmm. And directors have said they like the attitude here because mm-hmm. from the police to the actors, everyone is excited about working. We're in LA, they're a little jaded and they've done it so many times. And they like it here, and there's a freshness about Vancouver. So we have to maintain that. But it's opened our eyes to all the talent that's here, which then comes to we've got to look after ourselves by creating Canadian produced.
Yes.
How can you help in that area as a minister?
Well, it's as I've talked to federal officials, it seems that there are a number of things the provincial government can do, the Minister of Culture can do, to organize and reorganize various functions mm-hmm. in a way that federal government might be able to help sponsor activity. For example, here's just an example. If you want to talk about training mm-hmm. for people in the arts, for example, animators, people who draw mm-hmm. To make cartoons or whatever, right. that comes under post-secondary, as does all most training. If you want to talk about the funding of arts and culture, it comes under the cultural services mm-hmm. branch, which is my ministry. If you want to talk about labor standards, it comes under labor. If you want to talk about film and film development, it comes under the Trade Commission mm-hmm. and Economic Development. There are six or seven different ministries, each of them doing
a lot of paperwork by the sounds of it. Typically government.
It's not so much the paperwork, it's the lack of paperwork, it's the lack of discussion, it's the lack of
the left arm doesn't know what the right
exactly.
arm is doing.
Paperwork I don't mind. You can mm-hmm. sort it and check it and deal with it. It's when people do not coordinate or integrate their efforts. We gotta do that. Mm-hmm. And we gotta make sure that both the industry and the federal government and the private sector that wants to invest are aware that there's a place that they can come, that there's an advocacy for them that's going to make the industry be able to do what it needs
right.
to do and get what it needs done. And that's, I think, my main focus for the film industry. This is what I want to see done. I want to see dare we call it a one-stop shop, but I would like to mm-hmm. say an integrated focal point where if a producer comes to town, or if a writer is in town looking for work, or if there is a need for a particular kind of technical backup or techie, or if there is a need for training, or if there is a grievance, mm-hmm. That there will be one place that deals.
They don't have to run everywhere.
That deals with their concerns. If there is right. a need for venture capital, or if there is a need for funding right. for an Indigenous Canadian film that yeah. might not necessarily make it unless it's bridged until production date or to distribution date.
Yeah.
This is the kind of thing I would like to see the cultural ministry capable of handling.
Now, the BC Motion Picture put forward a sixth plan of,
exactly.
of how they wanted increase in funding, you know, the things one can expect that
exactly.
they would lobby for as a lobby group. But they also asked, could there be one person that they could direct to? And you're voicing the same thing. Will you be that one person, or will you be looking to appoint that kind of a person?
Well, I have offered my ministry as the place to begin that integration. I have offered to the industry that I would be their advocate. Now it's my job to produce and to pull together all the ministries and all the agencies that are involved with film and production so that we can take it from a $250 million industry to a $1 billion industry, mm-hmm. which is around the corner, mm-hmm. basically. And just want to make sure it's done properly.
Are you going to do it in your next 4 years?
Wouldn't that be a terrific goal to shoot for?
It's New Year's.
Well, why not? But let's think about developing the capacity that that industry has and making government more efficient.
Mm-hmm. Right now, you're totally open. You're available.
Well, let's not say totally open. Let's just say that my calendar
was open.
Is as open as it can possibly be, that I have an exquisite staff, both here in Vancouver and in Victoria, that I take phone calls and answer them as soon as I can, and I try to set up appointments so that I can hear people's ideas and send them to the correct agency until we get the ideal framework set up. I want to be the listening post to make sure that the problems are all there and well understood.
Well, I hope that if we have this conversation in about 3 years,
yes,
that I can still get through to you on the telephone,
yes,
and that I can still voice my concerns, because the reality is, look at the ministries you've got under you. Tourism is a multi-million dollar industry. You've got culture. I mean, there are so many people that are going to be needing you and lobbying you. And I just wanted to talk a little bit about the Beacon Group. What happened there with the bridge on Boundary Road? I understood that there was supposed to be a lot of money from the federal government, and somehow the social credit let it slide, and now they're building this humongous studio in Blaine,
south of the border,
at the cost of they were going to invest $35 million, and now it's being built in Blaine. What happened there?
The tender was allowed to lapse because conditions simply weren't being met around the bridge. And what we've done since we've come into power is taken a look at the bridge studios to see whether or not they're doing what they should be doing for the industry and for the indigenous craft. And that the results of that we'll all be taking a look at over the next month or so, and we'll be making more definitive plans around the bridge studios and whether or not they're really serving the industry properly in the way they should. The decision, of course, has to be made as to whether or not the studios should be sold at all. Mm-hmm. And our government is making some decisions towards the notion of not selling. If you've got a good facility and if it's capable of being fixed up to serve the industry, perhaps it's best to keep it in public hands. Perhaps there are other alternatives than selling it off. Mm-hmm. But the Beacon Group has, which was the prime tenderer, has decided to build a studio in the south, or to the south of the border.
So you're still looking at it?
We're looking at the bridge, yes.
Good. Good.
Absolutely.
Okay, the other thing that I'm wondering about is the concern someone voiced to me the other day and said, I hope the NDP doesn't kill the movie industry. Reason they said that was the labor laws, minimum wages. There are a lot of people working in the industry because they want to, they're fascinated, and they're making $5 and $6 an hour.
Mm-hmm.
So anyway, see, that's a lot cheaper than what they're paying in LA.
Mm-hmm.
But people choose to be there at that rate, and they get fed, and they're in a movie. But is there any possibility that the government could get in there and there could be backlash because of that?
Well, I think that what we want to do is treat our workers fairly. We want to make sure that craftspeople that have been trained over the many years, that artists are not abused financially or otherwise. That, I think, is a bottom line. By the same token, I certainly would be opposed to heavy-handed legislation, and so would the labor movement, to come in and create closed shops on sites.
Mm-hmm.
I think that the performing artists and ACTRA and a number of the organized unions have been very amenable and have been very prepared to sit down with employers and government and discuss things through and talk them through. Nobody wants to lose work because Hollywood can go elsewhere. Neither does anybody want to be exploited.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And so there are a number of items on the list to be discussed with both the Hollywood producers and our local talent and craftspeople. And that's something that we'll be dealing with.
Okay. I want to move on to culture. You mentioned to me a little earlier that you have some plans to maybe get involved in some production yourselves with maybe the Open Learning Institute. What are the plans there?
Well, right now I'm just at the beginning stages of pulling together post-secondary ministry, the education ministry, economic development, and the cultural ministry, mm-hmm. just to begin a discussion around possible licensing for a knowledge network so that we can really develop a competent and efficient and effective TV studio broadcast capacity and work with private sector, public sector, do our own production, do our own development, create our own market, as you will, for our own BC Indigenous talent. And that will further open learning agency and the ability of people to learn by television, which mm-hmm. is what we're doing now with mm-hmm. Open Learning University of the Air, basically, but carry that three or four steps further into creating our own broadcast capacity here in BC on a licensed basis, which will, I gather, release federal funding to BC that will enable us to lever our dollars better and get a lot more people working in the arts, get a lot more people working on TV production.
So the Open Learning
The Open Learning Agency is just one capacity, just one agency in the larger picture. There's a new facility mm-hmm. being built out at Discovery Park at Simon mm-hmm. Fraser campus right now, and it has the capacity to, I'm told it has a fabulous capacity to do a huge number of things that Open Learning is only one small piece of.
So how would you be in comparison to the Knowledge Network then? Would you be
working
together?
Well, we'd be an extension of that. Extension. It would be, this is just mm-hmm. beginning mm-hmm. stages.
Oh yeah, oh yeah.
But we'd take the Knowledge Network and expand it, blow it into a full-scale broadcast BC, such as Ontario has in Ontario TV. It is one way of creating an economic generator, mm-hmm. of developing the industry, of feeding the private sector with good people, and keeping an Indigenous Canadian industry, helping it grow. It has to be costed out. We have to look at it. We have to see how it meshes with private sector. We have to develop a budget for it. But there is a willingness there.
Would it be a pay-as-you-view, or would we be looking for subscribers?
That would be interesting. I don't know. It all has to be reviewed, and a plan would have to be drawn up. But that is just the beginning of a real capacity here in BC to have a broadcast agency of its own.
Where did that idea get formed?
Well, one can only think of the CBC as being Canada's voice, and Ontario TV is being Ontario's voice. Perhaps BC could, with the assistance of the Department of Communications federally, develop its voice. And why not?
But it's not going to be especially politically controlled in any way, other than you're putting it all together?
Well, let us hope. Let us hope that it's a voice for British Columbia and Canada, mm-hmm. really. And let us hope that if it gets off the ground, that it serves a whole lot of different goals. Training, getting young people interested in broadcast film, developing a production facility that can be shared with private sector, and giving us access to the international market in film that we can sell our product to.
I can think right now of the arts itself. When I think of the, we've got BCTV, we've got UTV, and how little is being done with performers. Let's just pick on that because we've been talking on that earlier. But where do you turn on and see an excerpt of a play other than maybe a quick little clip on the news? Mm-hmm. Where do you get to meet the people who are the creators? that we all enjoy. So just for the arts alone, there is a real necessity to have a place where they can be heard and seen and watched. So,
mm-hmm. Yeah, well, we do have a talent pool in BC that we have never really capitalized on.
Mm-hmm.
I think that we keep it such a secret that British Columbia, this narrow coastal band, has such a wealth of people who are excellent at their craft and their art, whether it be Aboriginal art, which we are now just beginning to understand and take seriously as Aboriginal people rediscover their art and deliver it to the community. And we have this wonderful sense of being on the West Coast and the stuff that spins out of the coastal islands mm-hmm. alone are enough to make me really excited about the potential of art and craft in British Columbia. So the art galleries can't begin to express this talent. The small theaters that we have are just a beginning to the talent that we really do have, could show off to the community at large and attract mm-hmm. tourists in the process.
Exactly, yeah. Which we didn't even get to, and we've mm-hmm. come to the end of our time.
We have.
My half hour goes quick. But I've really enjoyed listening to your excitement about how you want to merge all the different groups together. And what shines through is your support of the artists, which is what we've sort of focused on in general. And whether it's, you know, with a TV program or just getting funds and connecting people together, I think they've got a really good spokesperson. And I hope I'll talk to you again and you'll be as excited as you are about the work that you
We just have to start to produce now and start to pull it together. Thank you, Sonja.
Thank you, Darlene. I really enjoyed that. And I really want to take this opportunity to thank Andersons for the use of this lovely location. And I hope you've enjoyed this conversation. I'm Sonja Baker.